morning, Saint Rest. All right, I'm happy to see your faces this morning. If you would, join us in our opening hymn, Lift Him Up, Lift Him Up, hymn number 547. Amen.
Reading 1 Corinthians chapter 12, spiritual gifts. Now about spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I tell you that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them in all men. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit the message of wisdom. To another, the message of knowledge by the means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And still to another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he gives them to them, each one, as he determines. Amen.
Amen.
Our hymn will be number 504, Love Lifted Me, number 504.
Savior wants to be. Father, we thank you for the greatest gift that you gave to us all, your darling son, Jesus Christ, who died on Calvary, that we may have the right to life, the right to salvation. Father, we thank you for the gift of our life, our health, and our strength. We thank you for allowing us to rest last night while you protected us from our hurt, harm, and darkness. And then, Father, you allowed our eyes to open and see the light of a brand new day, closed in our right mind. And then you protected us as we came across our highways and byways. Father, I ask you to have mercy on those under the sound of my voice this morning, whether they be with us in the sanctuary or here on social media. We realize that we are weak, we are mighty. We can't do anything without that aid and assistance. Father, we come in knowledge of your word. You say that we lean not to our own understanding, that you would direct our path. Father, we ask you to direct us this morning. Direct us in our sanctuary. Direct us in our home. Direct us in our school, Father. Direct us on our job. Help us to be the type of life that you need, standing for you in these last and evil days. Father, we ask you to look down on the leaders of this nation and let them know that you are God and beside you there and no other. Father, look down on the leaders of this city, Father. Bless us. We have violence and killing everywhere, Father, but we know that in your own time, all the answers lies in Jesus Christ and you will correct it. You said in your word that if we humble ourselves and pray, repent, turn from our wicked ways, and seek you, that you would hear us from heaven and heal our land. And Father, we ask you to heal our land if it be your will. Thank you, Father, for the leader of this flock, this congregation. Bless him, Father, in his absence. Bless the man who you have sent to declare your word today, Father. Open up our hearts and our minds and our ears so we may hear what you have said to us. Father, we thank you. We ask you to look down on those who may be suffering through the hospital. Have mercy on those that are prison bound. And be with those families that may be enduring bereavement during this time, Father. We know that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Father, we ask you to continue to guide us. Help us, Father. Don't let us run this race in vain. Look down on us as we continue to look up on you, realizing, Father, that you have put us here for a certain time. We won't be here always, but you promise in your word that in the Father's house there are many mansions. And Father, at that time that we leave this place, we ask you that you receive us in that place that you have prepared from the foundation. These and other blessings we ask in the name of Jesus, our Son. Amen.
Yes, Lord. God, look before the word of Christ, we lift up the throne of grace. Father, you did it once again. You woke us up this morning. Father, in fact, there are some things that you told us not to do that we did. But you woke us up this morning. But Lord, not only did you wake us up this morning, but you stood us up. God, we're clothed and we're in our right mind. Father, we don't want to take for granted what you've done. So even though in the midst we have prayer requests, Father, we want to pause right here to tell you thank you. Thank you for the mercy you gave us when you woke us up this morning. Thank you for allowing us to make it back to your prayer house once again. Thank you for covering our house and covering our family. Father, we thank you. Father, in fact, if we had 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough to tell you thank you. Father, you've been good to us. Father, in spite of a pandemic, we can shout because you've still been good to us. Father, you still open up doors. Father, you still touch blind eyes. Father, you still made a way out of nowhere. And so, Father, we tell you thank you. God, I ask that you would forgive us all of our sins. Father, search the inner depths of our heart. If there's anything that does not bring glory to your name, God, I ask now that you would remove and cast it in the sea of forgiveness, never to rise again. Father, I ask a special covering over the pastor of this church. Continue to crown his head with wisdom and knowledge. Father, continue to direct his path. Father, I pray for his wife that you continue to give her the strength to stand alongside him as he served this present age with the gospel of Jesus Christ. But God, I won't be selfish. I ask that you bless my congregation, the Tabernacle Baptist Church. Father, I pray that you bless Wayne to send a word to the people this morning. And God, I pray for the St. Rest Baptist Church. Father, bless them individually, but God, bless them collectively. Father, continue to unite this congregation as one. Continue to allow this congregation to be a beacon light in this dark community. Father, for whatever time that we need the church, Father, is right now. So help the church. Help us to take our faithful stand, and that's at the forefront of all of these things that's going on. Father, whoever it is that is often during this time, Father, they might have unspoken prayer requests. God, I ask that you will give them the strength to give it to you and trust that you're going to make a way out of no way. Father, someone's struggling with some situations right now, but Father, help them understand that even in the midst of times like this, you are still giving peace that surpasses all understanding. Father, in fact, you told us that we have not because we ask not. And so, God, here we are asking, seeking, believing that you will do what you always do. And that's come through not on our time, but on your time. And Father, we thank you in advance for what you're going to do. In fact, we're not going to wait till the battle is over. We're going to shout and give you praise right now. And it's in the marvelous, matchless, majestic name of the Master we pray. And by faith, we count it all done. Amen.
Son and daughter. My soul
with sorrow in my heart every day. How long will my enemy have the upper hand? Turn and answer me, O Lord my God. Restore the sparkle to my eyes, or I will die. Don't let my enemies gloat, saying, we have defeated him. Don't let them rejoice at my downfall. But here is my shout. But I trust in your unfailing love.
Yes.
I will rejoice because you have rescued me. And then the closing verse says like this, I will sing to the Lord because he is good to me.
Amen.
You may have your seats. For as well as the plow of the earth fadeth away, but the word of our God shall stand forever. I want to tag this text, the struggles of the soul. If I was to survey the room by a show of hands, actually we had been in church over 20 years, there would be quite a few people that would raise their hand. If I said over 30 years, over 40 years, and you remember when XYZ was being done, you would raise your hand and say, Pastor, Reverend, I was there. In fact, you also testify I gave the Sunday school. I was at BTU. I was at the Joint Lord's Supper services. I went to every second service. I went to Bible study. I taught Bible study for a little bit. But if you was honest and open, even after serving God, even after paying your tithes and offering, after treating everybody right, after loving people that you know don't like you, you still have had to struggle. Listen, we look good this morning. We got our Sunday best on this morning. We came with our Sunday best to give God our best. But if we just be honest with ourselves, even when we were dressed up, made up, we still had to struggle.
Yeah.
Well, how do you know that we've had to struggle? Because Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 33, he says, in this life, you will have trials and tribulations. He didn't say you might have. He said you will have. And the people, not people that don't go to church, ain't the only ones that struggle. Some of us that love the Lord, that preach his gospel, that play his instruments, that sing songs, sometimes it seems like we catch more hell than everybody else. So I want to go ahead and throw this out there parenthetically for whatever it's worth. I don't care how good you look. I don't care how long you've been in church. I don't care what family you come from. You are not exempt from struggle. Did you hear what I said? I said, it doesn't matter what family you come from, what financial background, how many degrees you have, because I know folks that got degrees that still ain't got no job. You will struggle. In fact, Dr. Joseph Parker remarks that this song begins with winter and it ends with summer. The hymn begins with a low, muffled tone expressive of sorrow, almost hopelessness, and it gradually turns into a burst of thanksgiving. As we discover this altar, David sings himself out of a crisis. This specific crisis was called the summer's distress. It's difficult to pinpoint. It may have well been that David wrote this song during the time he was being hunted by Saul. In fact, David was afraid to rest and close his eyes because he figured if he closed his eyes, he would never wake up. But I ain't got to just read Psalm 13. I can survey. There's some people in here. You've been up all night trying to fight a situation that you knew that you could not do anything with. You had to drown your pillows with your tears. You've cried yourself. You woke up crying. You done went to work crying. You done talked to everybody crying. But I want to put this right here. It doesn't matter how many people you know with resources. If you do not know the source, all you have is a bunch of resources. Is that I see it so much on Facebook. We will take all of our problems to Facebook with people that cannot help us, but we will not give our problems to God. And I think that's why so many people and friendships fall out, because we're too busy on Facebook, our house with the hunt. Get on Facebook and put your face in the book. And so I want you to see the move, this text, I want you to see the first thing I want you to see is the soul's agitation.
right there, David said, how long, Lord? How long will you forget me? How long shall I take the counsel in my soul? How long should I have to deal with this stuff? Four times, David asked the question, how long?
How long?
The sweet psalmist of Israel asked four times, how long? A man after God's own heart asks the question four times, how long? It doesn't matter what position you occupy in the church or what kind of favor you think you have with God, there will be times when you got to ask God, how long, Lord? How long, Lord, you going to let the enemies get the upper hand? How long are you going to cause those people that keep talking about me a scandal? How long are you going to continue to have everybody that I try to touch turn around and still talk about? How long will I have to endure the things that I'm going through in this moment? The trial in which David, he was passing, had brought him into a state of dread and depression. David was simply saying right there in the verse before that there was no sense of God's presence. He said, how long will you forgive me, O Lord? And he said, forever. How long will you hide thy face from me? No believer can make it without the hand of God.
Amen.
No, I don't care how much money you got. I don't care how much education you got. None of us can make it without the hand of God.
That's right.
David in the city, he felt he had no sense of God's presence. And if you look back when Jesus was on the cross, Jesus asked the question. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now you have to understand, Jesus is God in flesh. But even in the moment when Jesus was on the cross, Jesus had to ask God, why have you forsaken me? Because when God turned his back on you, it's impossible for you to keep living. I know people that show up at church every Sunday that still don't have a sense of God's presence. I know people that sing in the choir, some of us that minister behind the sacred desk every Sunday, but there is no sense of God's presence. In fact, if you remember the strong brother by the name of Samson, Samson had it going on. You know, Samson was strong, he was handsome. I think that was me. But he was strong, you know, he had it going on. And Samson put his head in the wrong lap and got a bad haircut. But watch this. When the Philistines came upon them to fight, the Bible said that Samson went out to fight. But here is what I want you to see. Samson went out to fight, but the text said that when he went out to fight, the glory of the Lord had departed from him. Watch this. And he didn't even know it. I don't want to show up for worship on Sunday to work to realize that God has already fired me. Because you can still sing and not have God's presence. You can still preach and not have his anointing. You can still tithe and lift your hands in the sanctuary and God has taken his hand off of you. But not only was there no sense of God's power, there was no sense of God's purpose.
Come on now.
He said, how long shall I take counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart?
Yeah.
Here the psalmist confesses the utter failure of all of his plans because God's plan, he did not feel it. He complained about everything. David was all that he was supposed to be in God, and he still felt empty because he had no sense in purpose. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom and his righteousness. And all these things, come on, help me Sunday school, will be added unto you. You cannot get your purpose until you seek the kingdom. And you know why so many people's life fall apart? It's because God is the plan B, not the plan A. See, I never knew God was all I needed until he was all I had. I did not know he was everything I needed and some more until I tried it for myself. See, I used to shout in church. I used to shout out my grandmother's prayers, you know, and I used to laugh at the sister that shouted because I'm like, man, don't nobody make you shout like that. You just in here acting a fool. You don't know what you're shouting about. You just going through the motions. You playing church. So when we would go home, I would play church. And I was always the preacher, you know, shouting, wearing the big t-shirt with the robe on, talking about he died. But now, I'm at a point in my life, I ain't playing church no more. I'm having church. Because when you discover a purpose that God has given you, it makes it easy for you to come in church, even when you know that folk don't like you, and still lift your hand. Even when you know they're talking about you, and you still satiated down the aisle like the Lord has been good to you. There was no sense of God's purpose. That's the soul's agitation. But secondly, I want you to see the soul's supplication. David says, consider and hear me. Light my eyes, lest my enemies should say that I have prevailed against him. Agitation for the believer should lead to supplication. When your soul is agitated, that's when you're supposed to get on your knees and give your problem to the Lord. He said, son, do your knees hurt? I said, no, sir, I'm in good health. He said, I know, because he said, you ain't on them enough. And the reason why most of our knees are not hurting is because we're not on them enough. And I'm a little with you. When you pray, things will change. But watch this. If the situation don't change, prayer will change your perspective in the middle of your situation. God, your prayer is not going to always get you out of situations. It just invoked the presence of God to get in the middle of it with you. You need some help, don't you? Daniel chapter 3, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when they were thrown into the midst of the furnace, even though they had a relationship with God and they were spiritually connected to God, God did not stop them from being thrown in the furnace. He just got in there and cooled it off. You need another one, don't you? Daniel chapter 6. When Daniel realized that the writing had been signed, Daniel still went in his chamber, Daniel chapter 6, verse 10, with his eyes and his heart lifted up toward Jerusalem, got on his knees, prayed and gave thanks three times as he did a fourth time, even though he prayed and he seeked and he did everything God told him to do, he still was thrown in the furnace. But what the people did not understand was, yes, I'm going to kill him, but God said, no, and you go ahead and go in the furnace, I'm just going to allow you to get some sleep in the middle of your career. Because when you trust God, when you pray to God, God will always take your problem away from you. He'll just cause you to go to sleep right on top of your trouble. You need one more witness, don't you? I know. When Jesus went to the cross, they figured, well, if we're going to kill him, we can stop this movement right now. But Jesus said that no man takes my life, I lay it down. And if I lay it down, you best believe I'm going to pick it up again. Because he left me and said, if I can lift it up from the earth, I'll in their power, but on Sunday morning, God got it woke in his power. And that's why he was able to step and declare and decree, I got all power in my hand. God will not stop you from going through your troubles. God will just give you peace in the middle of your troubles. David was asking God for a fresh revelation of God. He said, lighten my eyes, realign my focus. The Bible makes it clear when it says, he that cometh to God must believe that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. When you go to God and pray, you got to believe that God will make a way. You got to shout on credit that God will supply your need. You wait until your situation is over. You wait until, you know, you get to that check in the mail, and you wait until you get another stimulus, and you wait until you get the PPP loan, and you wait until you get the new house. But the fact of the matter is, you didn't shout when you got the house. You shouted when you got approval. You shouted in advance. And prayer is nothing but a conversation made possible by Jesus Christ for you to give your troubles to the Lord and shout in advance for what he's about to do. God, I don't know what you, but I'm going to lift my hands anyway and just tell you that. I don't know what area you're about to show up in, but I'm going to shout right now in advance so when I get to where you got me, I already know how to act.
Come on, man.
And see, some of us don't, well, see, some of us are so we were so dignified and biblically stupid and pseudo-religious that we forgot how to shout.
All right.
You know, people tell you to give the Lord a hand clap of praise, you know, you just, you know. You know how you do it. Come on and give the Lord some hand clap of praise and look at your neighbor and you mugging your neighbor. You must, that was, see, I wish we would go back to some of the stuff that the old church did. I wish that we would take the cushion off the seat and put just the wooden pews on it. I wish we would take the coffin out the church so that when the deacon would walk, you would hear them. You would hear them when they're coming down out, when they walk. I wish that they would take the nice balusters out and just put the tub back behind the church like they used to have. I wish we would take the central aisle and put the center fans back with the air conditioners in the window, because those folks had some church. Them folks said I wouldn't have a religion that I couldn't feel sometimes. Them folks said the Lord will make a way somehow win for me because I bow. They had some church. They sung Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm out there from the hills. God good me, I say, you talking about Jesus? He's a friend of mine. That was say, it's getting late in the evening. The sun is almost going up. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not walk. Oh, we dignified now. Come on. We got a couple instruments now. We forgot how good God is. Listen, I'm 27. I was raised in the old church. There's just some things I ain't going to apologize for. And I ain't going to apologize for giving God my best friend. If he gave me money to buy clothes to look good in the midst of people that don't like me, I figure I'm going to come in church and tell him everything he gave me. Because in the words of my pops, Dr. Johnson, what I am, God made. What I am, he gave. What I know, he taught. And what I come from, he brought me. So since I figure I know who brought me, I ain't going to wait on you to shout. The musician ain't got to hit my key. The old church said, I woke up this morning. With my mind stayed up. I'm walking and I'm talking. With my mind stayed on. It's quitting time. I told you the soul's agitation. I told you about the soul's supplication. But lastly, I want you to see the soul's jubilation. It's right there in the text. David said, but I had trusted in thy mercy.
Yeah.
He said, my heart shall not fail, and my heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. I will sing unto the Lord. Your translation says, because he's dealt bountifully with me. But the New Living Translation said, no, he's been good to me. I went through some stuff. I done had a couple of situations. I thought I wasn't gonna make it out. But David said, he's been good to me.
Yeah.
COVID has been around, you know, Saul, people trying to kill me, people lying on me, they scandalizing my name, my job, trying to lay me off. And I got all these internal problems, my kids acting up, I get one straight, the other one start acting half crazy. I got family members that always want money, about to get on my nerve, but I still testify on Sunday. The Lord has been good to me.
Yes.
And if God has been good to you, you shouldn't need me to push, pump, pride, and coach you. You just ought to give it to him. Yeah. God gave David full restoration and left David with a confirmed faith. He said, but I have trusted in thy mercy. The past tense of the verb describes faith not as something to be felt hereafter or just a beginning to be felt at present, but it's already exercised and cherished.
Yeah.
David said, I'm good now. He renewed my strength. He got it together. But not only did he give him a confirmed faith, he gave him a renewed soul. David said, my heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. I will sing unto the Lord, for he has been good to me.
Yeah.
And I remember when God delivered the Exodus chapter 15, when God delivered the children of Israel out of the Red Sea, the first thing that they did was not gossip, but they sung.
Come on now.
Yeah.
Not get on Facebook and take a picture of look at me now, look at where I come from. They sung a song.
Yeah.
And the song, in fact, Miriam said it like this, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. He has hurled both the horse and the rider into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has given me the victory. This is my God, and I will praise him, and my Father's God, I will exalt him.
Yeah.
The Lord is a warrior, and Yahweh is his name.
Yes.
Well, you probably saying, well, Reverend, I didn't get that. But I got one for you. I'm 27, but I'm an old soul. In fact, I was listening to it on my way here. I almost had to pull over and make out I was going to be late to church because it got good to me. My favorite group is called The Temptation. Yeah, don't judge me. I love The Temptation. The Temptation had a struggle of the soul. The Temptation started going through some stuff. But then my brother, my colored brother by the name of David Ruffin, stepped up to the microphone and said, I got sunshine.
Come on.
Yeah, I feel my help now. On the cloudy day. When it's cold outside, oh, you know it, don't you? I got the month of May. He said, I guess you say, what can make me feel this way? Now, David Ruffin said, my girl. Now I was shouting in the car when he was talking about my, you know, I was getting a little step on, you know, I'm a one or two step. But I'm in church. I can't testify like David
Ruffin. Come on now.
Mine is, I got sunshine on the cloud today.
Come on.
Yeah. When it's cold outside,
yeah.
I got the month of May.
Yeah.
Same rest, I guess you say. What can you make a 25-year-old one preacher feel this way? I ain't talking about my girl. Yeah, I'm talking about my God. He's a shelter in a time of storm. He's a friend when you're friendly. He's bread when you're hungry. He's water when you're thirsty. I feel my Sunday school lesson now. He's Adam's redeemer. He's Abel's vindicator. He's Abraham's sacrificer. He's Noah's ark. He's Moses' bush on fire. He's Joshua's battle axe. He's Gideon's fleece. He's Samson's power.
Thank you. If he brought you out. works in you.
To him be the honor and glory in the church and in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
The door of the church is now open. This is your opportunity, this is your chance to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. To you to accept Jesus while you have time. If you got to think about being saved, then you're not saved.
The drive will be August the 7th from 10 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. We will be packing the backpacks, and at 1 o'clock p.m. we will have a drive-by giveaway. You are invited to a revival and worship service at Mount Bethel No. 1 Baptist Church, located at 12535 Mansfield Road, Keysville, Louisiana. This is starting this Monday, July the 26th through Wednesday, July the 28th at 7 o'clock p.m. nightly. Pastor Michael Fajay will be the guest evangelist. Members, please come out and support. Deacons are asking to meet after church for a few minutes today. And I have a thank you card I would like to read. Saying thank you doesn't seem like enough to show how much your caring and thoughtfulness has meant. But though the words are simple, hope you know how much warmth and appreciation comes from them. Thank you for love, support, and prayers, the beautiful resolution as well. May God continue richly to bless the St. Brett's family. This is from Sister Patty Holloway, Pastor Fajay's mother. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Amen. Is there anything else that needs to claim your attention? Amen. Shall we stand? Amen. I know you're all customary. You all give offering apples. Amen. This opportunity to give as you leave out of the door. Let me say thank you, Sam Rest, for thank you, Pastor Michelle.
today for inviting me. Saint Louis, thank you for accepting me. People don't have to be nice, and certainly they don't have to be nice to you. But when they are, they don't take a college degree to say thank you. Repeat after me: much prayer,
much power.
Little prayer,
little power.
No prayer,
no power.
You are dismissed.